Here is your source water. What do we have to do to make it look so? And if it looks like this, is it really safe? During this lecture, we will find out about different water treatment steps, processes and technologies, understand basic principles behind most commonly used technologies. We will also discuss advantages, disadvantages and limitations of each treatment process. All water treatment methods can be divided in 5 major groups, which can function as a single step treatment or should be applied as a part of a large multi-stage treatment. The 5 groups of methods are structured around the type of contaminants removed by the method. Source groups are clarification, which is removal of particulate matter, inactivation of microorganisms, also called disinfection, desalination for removal of salt from the water, and reduction of concentrations of geogenic and anthropogenic contaminants to meet water quality guidelines. A meaningful combination of technologies is in most cases necessary to achieve the WHO water quality standards for safe drinking water. The purpose of clarification is to remove as much as possible particulate material. The conventional treatment systems usually apply coagulation, flocculation, combined with sedimentation or filtration. Rapid sun filtration without coagulation is used as well on large centralized drinking water treatment plants or community supplies. In community supplies, rough infiltration has been used successfully as efficient and low maintenance pretreatment. Coagulation is usually a pretreatment step. Its goal is to change the fine dispersed particles into larger agglomerates that can be removed by sedimentation or filtration or both. In coagulation process, a metal salt such as aluminium or iron salts are added to water containing dispersed, often negatively charged particles. Aluminium or ions destabilize the particles by neutralizing their charge. Water is being mixed rapidly and pH might need a correction. These destabilized particles form flocs which grow larger during slow mixing and finally settle down and can be easier filtered out. On this picture, you see a mobile water treatment plant where coagulant is added in this tank. Another method of reducing particulate matter content is a rapid sun filtration. Water passes through the filter media, which is coarse or medium-sized sand, which is loaded over the more coarse gravel layer. During filtration, solids get trapped, settle or adsorb onto the sand material. After trapped material accumulated in the first layers, the filter requires backwashing, reverse flow of water to remove accumulated material. The filters are operated at linear velocity of 1 to 40 meters per hour, which is considerably higher than in slow sand filters, which we discuss later. For rather turbid waters, rough filters can be used prior to rapid or slow sand filtration or disinfection. Differently sized coarse material is used in rough filters. The size decreases in the direction of flow. There are different configurations of rough filters: upflow, downflow, or horizontal flow. In an upflow filter you see here, water moves from down to top and the retained solids accumulate predominantly in the bottom of the filter. They can be flushed out by reversing the flow or simply draining the filter. Disinfection of drinking water ensures that bacteria, viruses and protozoa have been inactivated or removed from water so they do not longer pose health risk. Disinfection is always done after clarification and not before, as particles reduce the efficiency of many disinfectants. Disinfection by chlorination is most commonly used method. Chlorine or sodium hypochlorite can also be produced on site by generators using electrolysis of salt. Ozone and UV light inactivate microorganisms, while slow sun filtration or membrane are based on filtration purely or combined with biological processes. When chlorine is dissolved in water, it forms equilibrium between the chlorine, hypochlorous acid, and hypochloric acid. When chlorine is added to water, it reacts first with reduced compounds and is being destructed. At a higher dose, it reacts also with organic matter and nitrogen species to form chlororganic and chloramine compounds. If you look on this figure, we can see that at first the chlorine residual will increase proportionally to the amount of chlorine added, until the mole ratio of ammonia to chlorine is about 1. Beyond that, additional chlorine reduces total chlorine residual due to oxidation of some chloramine species. Breakpoint is a point at which complete oxidation of all chloramine species occurred. The location of this point depends on the presence of organic matter, nitrogen, and reduced inorganic ions. After the breakpoint is reached, free chlorine residual proportionally increases with a chlorine dose. The part of chlorine which participates in disinfection and is called chlorine demined. Chlorine residual is a chlorine which remains in water after the disinfection process has been predominantly completed and acts as a safeguard against additional microbial contamination that could be introduced in water or in distribution network at the point of use. Recommended residual chlorine concentration is about 0.5 mg per liter of free chlorine, which should be applied to water during at least 30 minutes. Chlorine dose is being expressed in concentration multiplied by contact time, called CT value. CT99 means the concentration and time required to kill 99% of target microorganisms. In case of bacteria, the CT values are low, indicating the inactivation of bacteria occurs relatively fast and at low concentration. The time and concentration are considerably higher to inactivate viruses and very high for protozoa. Cryptosporidium oocysts are resistant to chlorine, which often does not provide sufficient level of inactivation to protect from a disease. Presence of particulate matter in water leading to high turbidity of water compromise chlorination, and water has to be clarified before it can be disinfected with chlorine. There are different forms of chlorine available, and it can even be produced on site by electrolysis of salt and water. The choice of the most appropriate form of chlorine will depend on such factors as scale and water volume, which needs to be treated, skills available, safety management practices, and power supply reliability. Ozone is a highly effective oxidant, not only disinfecting water, but also reducing color, micropollutant content, and other organic contamination. It is, however, expensive and doesn't provide residual protection. Due to high cost and relatively complexity, it is usually not used in an emergency context. In contrary, disinfection with ultraviolet light or UV disinfection is cheap and relatively simple. It inactivates microorganisms by damaging their DNA and RNA. In contrary to chlorination, it is also efficient against protozoa. No supply of chemicals is also an advantage of this method. However, it doesn't provide residual protection, requires reliable power supply, and frequent cleaning of the UV lamps, which are the source of the UV light. As well as in case of chlorination, it is sensitive to turbidity, and water should be clarified before UV treatment. Slow sun filters are operated at a slow filtration rates of 0.1 to 0.3 meters per hour, compared to rapid sun filters which are operated at 1 to 40 meters per hour. Slow filtration rates allow development of a biological activity within the filter. Thus, a slow sun filtration is a combination of different biological and physical processes, including mechanical trapping, adsorption or attachment, predation, and natural death, leading to the reduction of solids but also micro and macroorganisms. Slow sun filters are usually downflow filters and are operated by gravity. Each filter requires ripening period of few days to few weeks until removal rates stabilize. Mainly the top layer of the slow sun filter contains a diverse microbiological community and particles, and it is also called Schmutzdecke. In the Schmutzdecke, predominantly the inactivation of microorganisms occurs. During membrane filtration, water is driven by pressure difference between the feed water and filtrate through a filter with pores of a defined size range. Usually polymeric membranes or sometimes ceramic membranes are used. Microfiltration has pores in the size of bacteria or higher and removes them and particulate matter by size exclusion. Ultrafiltration membranes are more tight and remove also viruses, which in the size of 20 to 80 nanometer. Nanofiltration requires considerably higher pressure as the pores are small, but it is capable of retaining micromolecules and larger ions. Small ions, such as salt ions, can be removed by reverse osmosis, requiring even higher pressure. For disinfection purposes, ultrafiltration membranes are most common, as an effective barrier against pathogenic microorganisms, including viruses and particles. Different configurations of membranes are available. In drinking water supply, hollow fiber membranes are commonly used. They can be different diameters and different ways. The water usually goes through the membrane inside and passes on the other side out. They can be also bound together in a bundle to have a high surface area. Spiral wound elements look like this, and basically this is a flat-sheet membrane which is rolled together in a spiral together with a spacer. Those are commonly used in desalination processes. In wastewater treatment in membrane bioreactors, flat-sheet membranes are used. Membranes need to be frequently backwashed to remove larger particles, microorganisms, and all kinds of material accumulating on the surface of the membrane. The layer which is formed on the top of the membrane is called fouling layer. The drinking water filtration systems often constant and reliable operation, which however requires high degree of automation, reliable power supply, and relatively high cost. There are also gravity-driven systems on the market and in development, more suitable for remote applications. Desalination is used to remove salt from sea or brackish water. Let's see. If a semi-permeable membrane is installed between pure and the saline water containers, pure water will be drawn by saline water, creating an osmotic pressure. In order to overcome this osmotic pressure, external pressure which is higher than osmotic pressure needs to be applied. Seawater has an osmotic pressure of about 25 bar. That's why reverse osmosis systems are operated at 30 to 70 bar to achieve movement of pure water from saline water through the membrane. That's why high pressure pumps and good power supply are required, as well as pretreatment to protect membranes from fouling. Chemical contaminants are either natural occurring chemicals in rocks and soils, such as fluoride and arsenic, or synthetic chemicals introduced in the environment through industrial waste and wastewater, agricultural practices, or untreated municipal waste. Adsorption of granular activated carbon, sometimes ozonation, as well as nanofiltration or reverse osmosis are common methods to reduce concentration to the acceptable level. It is quite a complex and costly process, and it is advisable to look for other water sources if this is possible, if concentration of synthetic chemicals are too high. Fluoride and arsenic are most commonly occurring geogenic chemicals, which pose a health risk. There are a few methods based on adsorption, coagulation, ion exchange, and membranes to reduce concentrations of these chemicals. All of them have advantages and disadvantages, and no best option exists yet. There is a large variety of different treatment technologies, and part of those we have not considered here. Some processes are still in development, and there are a few promising systems which exist only as pilot plants. Nevertheless, in this course, we considered major conventional drinking water treatment steps, which include clarification and disinfection. Disinfection is not efficient if water is turbid, and thus clarification needs to be done before. Geogenic and anthropogenic contamination of water requires special additional treatment steps, which adds complexity to the system. Desalination of seawater is complex, has high energy demand, and often only appropriate in cases where ultimately no other water sources are available. So, we have clarified and disinfected this water. Now it looks like this. There is even chlorine inside. Let's drink it.